Thanks, Red.
Yes.
I didn't have my wig on today, so hopefully everybody's not going to be too blinded by the glare or anything. But we'll see. We'll see. Thanks for coming out, everyone. I really appreciate it. And just like everybody else, I'd like to thank Red and William and Amy and the rest of the planning committee for really putting this together and doing such a great job, getting, with the exception of myself, great lineup of speakers here. And we'll see how the first guy is. So. From as far back as I can remember, right, from as young as I can remember, I have wanted to study things. I've wanted to learn about things. I've wanted to understand the world around us. So in other words, what I've wanted to be from a very young age, maybe not quite this young, but a very young age, is an ologist. An ologist, all right? Now, when I was about five, what I wanted to be was a paleontologist, because let's face it, dinosaurs are awesome. I mean, they're big and they can, you know, crush things, and when you're small, it's awesome to think about being big. And so I wanted to be a paleontologist at first. And then, as I continued to grow, I really became interested in archaeology, because I thought that punching Nazis and finding cool old would be awesome for a career. Just fantastic. As I got a little bit older, I found out that actually most archaeologists just, sorry about the mic, I found that most archaeologists just sit in rooms all day and read dusty old things. So I became more interested in biology and actually started out my college career as a biochemistry major. Just, you know, learning how the body works and consequently how the rest of us works, our mind, which is really just an extension of our body, became fascinating. But then I spent several weeks studying the growth of yeast cells in a laboratory by myself at 2 a.m. in the morning, and I thought, I don't think so. So instead, I decided to switch to psychology, which is where I am today and what I've been doing for the last 14 years. For those of you who are a little worried, your brain does not actually look like this. It's pink, and it doesn't have lightning shooting that far out from it. So no one freak out right now. So I've, you know, been for the last 14 years a psychologist, and, you know, regardless, through my entire life, I've, like I said, wanted to be an ologist of some kind. And all of the kinds of ologists that I wanted to be were scientists, it turns out. Different kinds of studying behavior in a scientific fashion, studying extinct animals, studying the body. I was just very interested in being a scientist, it turns out. But as I grew and got older and learned more and more about the world, what I found out was that it turns out that just being an ologist does not ensure that you are actually scientific. It turns out that there are hundreds and hundreds of different kinds of ologists out there, and very few of them are actually scientific. But to the layperson who hasn't had the benefit of training in a scientific field, or, you know, going to college and learning that things like, for example, graphology, which is the study of handwriting, is total and complete bunk, despite what court TV would have you believe. So it turns out that it's really hard for a lot of people out there in the world to distinguish between the kinds of ologists that are scientific and the kind that are pseudoscientific. And this, it turns out, is an extraordinarily important thing to do. Because it has implications not just for any one individual, but for society as a whole, and that's what we'll be talking about today. So if we're going to be distinguishing between the good and then the bad and the ugly, how are we going to go about doing that? You know, how are we going to go about distinguishing science versus pseudoscience, separating the wheat from the chaff, which is what my talk was titled? Well, the first thing we have to do is decide, what are we looking at, right? What are we looking at? Are we looking at something that's empirically based, that's scientific, like our friend Charles here? Or are we looking at these things that are conjecture, these things that are non-scientific in multiple ways? For those of you who can't tell, that's actually L. Ron Hubbard in the funny hat. I don't remember him wearing one of those in real life, but I wouldn't be surprised. So what we need to do is, like any good scientist, first we have to operationally define what it is that we're talking about. So in other words, we have to first talk about what science is. You know, what is science? This is my favorite definition of what science is. Science is a set of methods designed to describe and interpret observed or inferred phenomena, past or present, and aimed at building a testable body of knowledge open to rejection or confirmation. And that's, you know, kind of a big wieldy definition. But if you look at the parts that I've bolded, those are the key parts that really differentiate science from other forms of quote-unquote knowing. So it's methods. Science is not one field. Science is not biology. Science is not psychology. Science is not paleontology. Science is not archaeology. Those are all sciences, but that's not what science is. Science is methods, right? Science is the way that you go about learning about the world. And it's this way that has become testable, right? So in other words, you're testing what you know or don't know about the world. You're not just saying, this is what I think, we're going to stay there, we're good. No, it's this is what I think, let me test that. Let me see what there is out there that rejects or confirms this belief that I have. So, you know, that's science in a nutshell, but science is also, you can think about it as a toolbox, right? A set of skills designed, quite literally, to prevent us from fooling ourselves. It turns out that we are fantastic at believing things that are not actually real. I know that's going to come as a giant surprise to most of you. Sorry to have burst your bubble on the human race. But it's true. I mean, we believe things, and we seem to have evolved to believe things that are not necessarily true. And we stick to those, and we keep those, and we hold those. And that's what we do. And that's what science is here to help you with, is preventing you from fooling yourself, from believing things that are not necessarily accurate. You can also think about it as learning to minimize your thinking errors. We as humans come with this nice little set of thinking errors that we all make. As a clinical psychologist, one of my primary jobs with my patients is to help correct those kinds of thinking errors, help to look at the world in a different, more adaptive fashion. And science is self-correcting. Unlike most other forms of quote-unquote knowledge, science is self-correcting. It changes. If you look at science today, in 2012, and you compare that to science just 50 years ago, it's massively different. Our techniques are different, our knowledge is different, we understand things better. And this is very different from pseudoscience and other forms of knowledge, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And then finally, science is responsible for modern society as we know it. And that's, I think, pretty unarguable. Most of us would not be here today if it was not for science in one fashion or another, whether it be the cars that you drove or you being alive because of some sort of medical advance. Science truly is responsible for modern society. And so if we think about science in terms of a method or a set of methods, here's one way that you can go about it. So in other words, here's how science works. So this is what I call the science flowchart. And I apologize if it's kind of small, but it's big and it's unwieldy. So you'll have to sort of bear with me a little bit. So we start by getting an idea. It's the bedrock of science, getting an idea. Right? It's thinking, I wonder if X is related to Y. Or what would happen to Z if I change W? You get an idea and you say, I want to learn about this. I want to see what's going on here. So in other words, what you want to do is test it out. In science, we test things out by performing experiments. And there are a number of different kinds of experiments you can perform, and you guys can certainly read about those later or come talk to me if you want a very long, boring lecture. Later, I'm happy to provide those. I do so on a daily basis as my job as a professor. But I can talk about all sorts of experiments that you can do. But this is the key thing. You get an idea, you perform an experiment. You test out your idea. And then what you do is you look at what you get. You look at your results. And you say, does my evidence support my idea? Is my idea supported by this evidence or not? If no, then you say, bad idea. Bad. Throw that in the garbage can. We're done. And then you loop back up here. And you say, I need a new idea. I need a better idea. Let's take what I am knowing now, based on this experiment, and improve that. But let's say that you get lucky, and you're one of those scientists who can actually make experiments run well. And so, yes, your evidence does support your data. What that results in is helping to, at first, create a theory, an explanation of some sort of phenomenon in the universe. And so you create that. And what we use our theories, our scientific theories, to do is to better understand the universe and how it works around us. Scientific theories, as you're all aware, are not just guesses, right? Which is what sort of the lay definition of theory is. Oh, I have a theory about why they broke up. Well, you don't have a scientific theory about it. You have a, I have an idea about it, right? We're talking about scientific theories here, right? So you use this theory to better understand the universe. But we don't stop there. Right, we don't stop there. What we do is we do more experiments. We discover more evidence and new evidence. And then we say, okay, let's look back and say, can our existing theory about how this works, so why people have obsessive compulsive disorder, or how the universe was born, things like that, can my theory be modified to explain this new evidence? If yes, then that allows you to improve your theory, which then in turn loops back up here and allows you to better understand the universe. But if you say no, right, no, then we have what we call a scientific revolution or a paradigm shift, where things loop back to the start and you have to get a new idea. How many of you guys have heard of the theory of continental drift in here? Right, so you look on the globe and it looks like a bunch of puzzle pieces, right? And that's because at one point all of the current continents were a giant mass called Pangaea. The fellow who first put this theory out there in the early part of the 1900s was laughed at and ridiculed. His name is Alfred Wegener. Laughed at, ridiculed, told he was insane. Like, that's crazy. Continents don't move. And then more and more and more the evidence supported his theory. And so now if you go to a geologist and you say, hey, do you think continental drift is real? If any of them say no, you should not hire them for your oil and gas company. That's not something you should do, because they are vastly, vastly mistaken and wrong. Right? So that's just one example of a scientific paradigm or a revolution that's happened within the last 100 years, within some of your lifetimes. I see some young people out there. So I'm just kidding. So that's how science works. And science, like I said, is responsible for modern society. Many of you, speaking of longevity in life, wouldn't be alive today if this were 100 years ago. Just because of averages. So the room would be much smaller here. Because what we've seen since the 1830s is essentially a doubling of the human lifespan. And this isn't because we, you know, sat around and thought about it harder or we prayed more about people living longer. This was because scientific medicine and revolutions in how we understand the human body have allowed us to combat disease. How many of you guys have some sort of fake part in your body right now? Just the medical ones. Okay. Good. So a number of you. Yeah. Chances are 70 years ago, a lot of those people that raised their hand wouldn't be alive today. I'm very glad you are. And you can thank science for that. And science has allowed us to do these fantastic things like go to the moon. Go to the moon. That's insane. We landed on somewhere in outer space, right? It's allowed us to very, very, very close to now send something man-made out of our solar system, right? This is Voyager 1, which left Earth in 1977 and is now approaching the edge of our solar system. I mean, how cool is that? You know, it allows us to look at the night sky through things like the Hubble telescope and look at the Tarantula Nebula, for example, and see these beautiful things that we've never been able to see before modern science. But it also allows us to look at really, really small things that are very, very close to us. Cure diseases like polio, smallpox. Allow us to communicate instantaneously with people all over the world through telecommunications and the internet. This is an internet map. I don't know how you get from one point to another on it, but that is a map of the internet. So, you know, science is, in my view, just fantastic, all right, just fantastic. And again, to me, the most beautiful part of science is the self-correction. It's the self-correction. It's that we didn't just stay in one place. We didn't just say, here is the information that we have. I'm good. I'm good with that. Right, I'm done. I'm good with what was, you know, written down 200 years ago as scientific fact. So, you know, when you all get sick, it's time for the leeches and the bloodletting, and we may perhaps drill a hole in your head to let out the evil spirits. Now, that's probably not going to help you out a whole lot. You know that expression, you know, I need this like I need a hole in the head? Yeah, it turns out that means you don't need it. And so, you know, that's not terribly good for your health, it turns out. Now, pseudoscience, on the other hand, is very, very different. And that's the reason why it's called pseudoscience and not just science. Pseudo, of course, means false, like a pseudopod from, if you remember, you know, fifth grade biology or whatever. So pseudoscience can best be described as claims that sort of try and present themselves in such a way that they look scientific, they appear scientific, but at the same time, they don't actually have the evidence or the plausibility that actually supports something as being scientific. So in other words, they sort of dress up like science. Right? They try and act like science, but they don't have all of the safeguards of science. They rely typically on personal experience. Oh, no. I know that acupuncture works to cure tennis elbow. Well, how do you know? Well, I went to the acupuncturist. My elbow got better. So I know that it works. Well, really? Now, that's an anecdote. The plural of anecdote is not data. It's anecdotes. That's what it is. So it just relies on personal experience. I believe this because I believe it, because I think it happened. I crossed the path of that black cat, and then later I ran over a nail, had a flat, because of the black cat. Really? That's a powerful cat, right? Or just very sneaky, right? Just walking around, putting nails on the ground. If so, we should probably capture this cat, because it's dangerous. Or you can say it was a coincidence, right? And then pseudoscience does not test itself to fail. This is not what it does. What it does is it does not test itself at all, it turns out. So how do you know this is true? Well, because it happened to me. Ah, great, great. So obviously it's true then, right? Well, not necessarily. We'll see that. It tends to rely on the supernatural for explanations. One of my favorite pseudoscientists, and by favorite I mean most hated, is Deepak Chopra. For any of you who are aware of his Chopra-ness, he does a fantastic job of sort of relying on supernatural for explanations of things that are actually mundane. You know, someone got better. They had cancer. They got better. Well, it was because of the, you know, magical quantum mechanical physics with the universe as God. Oh, okay, thanks. That made no sense at all. But he says things like that and people believe it, right? People believe it and they trust him because he has built up this brand where he says the supernatural is good for explaining what happens to us. It's okay, it's useful. But it turns out that these things tolerate inconsistencies, right? That, which is one thing science does not do. If science has two competing theories to explain the same event, what you do is you test both those theories out until one of them proves correct or incorrect. In pseudoscience, not so much. So, for example, with something like astrology, which is, for those of you who are not aware, I was born on this day, so therefore I have this personality, as a result of the moon and the sun and the stars and all the planets. But it tolerates inconsistencies. The beginnings of astrology date back, in its current form, about 2,500 years. Now, 2,500 years ago, I don't know if you guys knew this or not, we didn't know what the planets and stars were. They were just these little, like, crazy points of light. And we've discovered new planets since then, which would throw a lot of things out of whack. But no, says astrology, we know we're okay. we'll just keep on being Libras and Virgos. And obviously, that means that 1/12 of the population has the exact same personality. Probably not, right? I was born in September, for example. Anyone else born in September? Good. There's some good people out there. We all have the same personality, right? I'm willing to bet no, just based on what we know about the scientific study of personality. Probably not. It has to do more with things like the environment that you're raised in and in your biology. Right? It doesn't have to do with when you were born and what star sign you're under. We also see that pseudoscience shows very little progression from when it began or started until the modern day. Chiropractic is a fantastic example of this. Chiropractic medicine, and you really should put the medicine part in quotes, is a pseudoscience. It really is. And most people, unfortunately, don't know this. It was started in the 1890s by a Canadian grocer. Thanks, Canada. Right? And then later Celine Dion, too. Really? I mean, come on. Not good. Not good, Canada. Started by this Canadian grocer who had this, you know, magical realization one day, this revelation from God, he said, that all of human misery could be cured by properly aligning the spine, which means that things like the germ theory of disease are, according to large numbers of chiropractors today still, not relevant and not real. Now, I don't know about you, but I've taken antibiotics before. They seem to have worked. I've had my vaccines. You know, I never got polio or anything like that. I'm willing to trust that evidence that we have over the last 100 years for germ theory much more than I'm willing to trust the revelations of a Canadian grocer. But not everyone is, it turns out. Right? And so we see little progress from inception to modern day for any pseudoscience. So what we then have is that pseudoscience is responsible for billions of wasted dollars per year here in the U.S. alone. Thousands and thousands of wasted manpower hours and womanpower hours. Yeah, that's an odd phrase, womanpower hours. Sorry about that. So, you know, we saw a little bit of what science has done for us in terms of healing diseases, traveling, you know, off the planet, being able to press a finger and this magical green light points up here, you know, things like that. Pseudoscience, what's it done for us lately? Well, first, let's look at how it works. Because it's key to understand the difference between science and pseudoscience, looking at how do these things work. So think back a few slides ago where I showed you the how science works, all right? Now, it turns out that they both start in the same way, which is that you get an idea. Good starting place, getting an idea. Now, pseudoscience, then, just ignores all contradictory evidence, keeps that idea forever in scene. We're done. It's really nice and easy, it turns out, to be a pseudoscientist. I mean, really, 1, 2, 3 steps, you're done. I think that wearing a purple hat while running in circles will cure PTSD. All right, good, I'm done. Right now I can write a book and I can be famous and make thousands and thousands of dollars off of you. Well, not if I'm a scientist. I would try and test that out first. Right? I would try and test that out. But this is not what pseudoscience do. Pseudoscientists get an idea, ignore anything that does not fit within the purview of their small worldview, and they're done. So if you go to a chiropractor, for example, and you call them out on it, and you say, so where's the scientific literature supporting the use of you compared to something like relaxation training or physical therapy to treat lower back injuries. They'll say, well, there are hundreds of thousands of us here in the United States. There are 40 in this town alone. Because they're everywhere, right? I mean, you drive down the street and it's just chiropractor, 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 chiropractor. Psychic, chiropractor, chiropractor, chiropractor. Starbucks, psychic, chiropractor, chiropractor. I mean, there's tons of them. So they must be real, right? Well, not so much, it turns out. It's really, really easy to be a pseudoscientist. And, you know, some of the fantastic contributions to society that pseudoscience has done over the last, let's just say, 2,000 years include astrology. Yeah. Everybody check their horoscope this morning? I hope you didn't. I mean, horoscopes are almost insulting, aren't they? You know, the idea that 1/12 of the entire human population would all get the exact same advice on a single day, I mean, that's just rude, you know? So if I and a guy in Siberia are born on the same day, or within the same month, apparently, within astrology, which really should have two S's up front, you know, we're going to need the exact same advice today. Probably not, I would guess, right? Or, you know, you go in the Congo, and someone who's living in the Congo and me, we need the exact same advice today. Watch out for something new to happen. Seize an opportunity. Don't be afraid to make a friend. Thanks. I appreciate that. You know, that guy's shooting someone and running for his life. I'm at home playing Mass Effect 3. I mean, it's probably not going to need the same amount of advice. Acupuncture. Another fantastic example of pseudoscience. I'm going to put a needle in your face, and it's going to make you feel better. Really? Who came up with that advice? You know, some sort of sadist, right? A couple thousand years ago, it was just like, you know what? I'm going to try and gullible. You know, there's some gullible people here. I'm going to stick a needle in you. Why? It'll make you feel better. Really? Yeah. Oh, okay. The first acupuncture patient, way too gullible. Way too gullible. Acupuncture, it turns out, not so real. Not so real. And we know this because we've run things like sham acupuncture trials. Sham acupuncture trials do everything except stick the needle in you. It feels like a needle goes in, it looks like it, but the needle does not actually break the skin. And it turns out it works just as well as regular acupuncture. It also works just as well if you place the needles in random spots on the body, which says it's a placebo effect. It's not a real effect. Another example of pseudoscience that has contributed massively to how we understand the world, believing the Earth is flat. Now, this is a pretty cool globe, but it's massively inaccurate, right? If I start sailing west from California, I don't at some point just fall off. Right? I mean, I might fall off the boat, but I wouldn't fall off the earth, right? If any of you ever tried weight loss, this is an example of a weight loss machine from the early 1900s, where people exercised in full and very dowdy clothing. I mean, I imagine you would lose weight if you did anything dressed like that just due to sweating. It's contributed in terms of, you know, making an impact on our education system. Not a positive impact, but an impact. Denying science, denying children the right to learn about the world as it is. So pseudoscience has contributed massively in some really fantastic ways. But you might be saying to yourself, so what? All right, thank you. So let's say that, you know, someone goes and they spend $50 on an acupuncturist. Who cares? It's their money, right? Let them do what they want to. Well, I don't feel that way, and I know many people who don't. And the main reason I don't feel this way is because of adorable little people like this. This is my son. He gets his cuteness from his mother, thankfully, not from this side. He is whip smart, right? Very smart, very highly verbal, loves playing with his Legos. He's a lot of fun, but you know what he's not? He's not a critical thinker. Now, you're saying to yourself, well, he's only like 3.5. Right, but you know what else? People who are 30.5 are also not critical thinkers. Because we are not naturally critical thinkers. We aren't. Our brains are not designed to critically evaluate science or evidence in the way that science is. We are easily, easily fooled. Right? And we're fooled in very simple ways. Go to a magic show. Show you that you can be fooled. How many of you have ever believed something in the past that you don't believe now that you know to be inaccurate? Yeah, you were fooled, right? We are very easily fooled, it turns out. We're not naturally critical thinkers. And so we have to educate ourselves and the young in order so that they do not fall prey to this pseudoscience, so that they don't go out and they spend money on things like shape-ups, right? There was recently, I think it was a $35 million lawsuit that was settled against Reebok because they falsely advertised these shoes, which would supposedly do all these magical things, right? You know what would have actually done most of these things? No shoes. Yeah, we didn't evolve wearing them. I don't know if you guys knew that or not. Like this, not very useful in the jungle or in the savannas. Not going to help. And so it turns out a lot of these things would be accomplished by not wearing shoes, not having giant, giant shoes, despite the fact that they made you, 3 inches taller, so you felt cool. Or something like this. The power balance bracelet, right? How many of you have seen someone wearing one of these? Yes. And then gone up to them and said, you know what, that's a little Is it just me? Well, it's good to know I'm not the only jerk in here. These are just ridiculous. There's lawsuits about those as well. Speaking of weight loss, the shake weight, right? I'm sure that if I got a shake weight, I would look like this in 2, maybe 3,000 years. Come on, right? But it's not just ridiculous stuff like that. It's the anti-vaccine movement. Yeah, boo, good, boo, right? It's the anti-vaxxers who are saying that things like vaccines cause shaken baby syndrome. No, shaking a baby causes shaking baby syndrome. That's not hard to figure out. It's, people protesting, still, science. For those of you who don't know, this is from a Futurama episode. People protesting science. And so, I'm not going to sit up here and pretend that science is infallible, that science holds every single answer all the time. But what I will say is that, what we know is that it's our best method for understanding the universe around us. It's the best way we have. And so, all of you, anyone out there can be a scientist. It doesn't take a lab coat, all right? It doesn't take highly advanced training in a particular discipline. All it takes is using that scientific method to evaluate claims. That's what it takes, and I want everyone in here to go out and be a scientist, right? I want all of our kids to be scientists. Not all psychologists, because I don't want all the competition, but be a scientist, all right? Be a scientist in your everyday life. That's what we need. So I'd just like to leave you guys with a quote from one of the founders of the Freethought movement, Robert Greene Ingersoll. Science is the enemy of fear and credulity. It invites investigation, challenges the reason, stimulates inquiry, and welcomes the unbeliever. Thank you.